Following our last video explaining object-oriented programming with metaphors without code, in this video, we will explore the solid principles with examples of codes. Object-oriented programming is a concept that is complex to learn and utilize. Not only acquiring knowledge on the grammars and functions related to object-oriented, but there's also a lot of trial and error involved in using them effectively in the field. In sports like tennis, optimal breathing methods, hitting techniques, and movement postures are documented as regulations, which were found through the experiences and attempts of former players. When it comes to designing software with object-oriented programming, there are known 5 guidelines to make more efficient, robust, and easily maintained programs, which are known as the solid principles. The various patterns of the object-oriented that you will learn from the next video are also based on these principles. Just as there are various exceptional situations in a tennis game, although mostly adhering to these solid principles turns out to be the optimal choice, please remember in practice that there are times when flexibility needs to be demonstrated. Now let's look at each of these principles one by one. In this object-oriented design pattern series, I will draft examples using Java, a widely used programming language that includes the main syntax and features related to OOP. You can check out the sample codes on the Notion page linked in the pinned comment. If you are using other languages, you can copy the examples on the Notion page and easily translate them into your preferred language using generative AI. To follow this video, you should be familiar with object-oriented programming concepts such as classes, objects, methods, and interfaces in languages like Java. If you don't know about them, I just want to let you know in advance that it might be hard to understand the examples explained in the video. First, there is SRP, the Single Responsibility Principle. Exactly as it sounds, each class should only have one responsibility. In the previous video, we linked the classes to jobs. A carpenter works on woodworking, a mason handles stones, a blacksmith creates tools. We need to create classes to exist for one specific job.
Does each class need to have only one method?
Not exactly. Multiple methods can be used for one responsibility. However, the typical job a class carries out through these should be just one. Let's take a look at the sample code. First, here's a code that violates this principle. This UserService class carries out 3 different tasks by itself. It saves a specific user's information in the database, it sends a welcome email to registered users, and even records each user's activities in a log. There are several issues with such code. First, the code of each class becomes complex, and it's difficult to intuitively understand their roles. Also, there are many reasons to modify each class, equal to the number of responsibilities it holds. A modification of one of those responsibilities could inadvertently affect the others. Because multiple responsibilities are intertwined in one place, testing and refactoring become tricky. There are also limitations in scalability and flexibility. Because these responsibilities are tied together, you can't just separate what you need and use it. Now, let's take a look at the code rewritten in compliance with SRP. As you can see, we've split the 3 responsibilities that were once packed into one user service into 3 separate classes. Just by looking at the names of the classes, you can guess what responsibilities each holds. A class responsible for storing user information, a class responsible for sending emails to users, and a class responsible for logging related to users can be easily identified. Each class only needs to modify its code when there are changes in the responsibility it has, and because classes are separated by responsibility, they are also easy to reuse as needed. In this way, the idea that each class is made with one task and purpose is the first one in the solid principles, which is the SRP. The second principle is the open-closed principle. This principle states that each class should be open for extension, but closed for modification.
The name of the principle doesn't quite connect with what it's saying. So, are you saying to extend the class rather than modifying it?
Yes, that's correct. Let's take a look at a sample code. It's a program that generates report documents as requested. The generateReport method of this class runs an if statement based on PDF or HTML given as an argument and generates a document in the corresponding format. In this sample code, only one line of code is written for each case like this. But in reality, very complex processes will take place here. Right now, we're only dealing with PDF and HTML formats, but what happens if we need to generate documents in other formats like XML in the future? This method will then have to be modified each time. As new cases are added, the code in this method will become more verbose and complicated. In that process, you could inadvertently affect the existing process, and there might be side effects in places where this method was already being used. Now let's look at the code applied with OCP. The function to create a document is made like this through an interface. It's an interface that defines the generate method. We don't write how the methods in an interface are performed. Just like this, methods name and form are only defined. The classes that apply this interface override this method and take responsibility to create documents in their own way. Now, if a new format is needed, you just create another class that applies this interface. In this way, you can design free from the issues that can occur during the process of modifying the existing code. The third is LSP, the Liskov Substitution Principle. LSP is the principle that a subclass should always be able to replace its superclass. To put it simply, a child should at least do everything the parent does. The place where the parent class object goes in should at least be able to perform the tasks the parent class used to do, even if the child class object gets put in that place. Let's take a look at this example code. In the parent class called bird, there is a method named fly. Because penguin is a subclass of the bird, it inherits this method. However, since the penguin is a bird that cannot fly, it cannot execute this method like the parent class. Fly, which works normally in the parent class, causes an exception in the subclass. Therefore, this becomes a wrong design. In such a situation, the fly method should not be a method inherited from the highest ancestor. It should be separated as an independent interface, as in the following example code. So, we are applying it only to those children of the bird class that can fly. The sparrow can fly, so it has implemented this interface, and you can see it's not applied to the penguin. So, there is no LSP violation in this code. Let's look at another example of violating LSP. This rectangle class has width and height properties, and it has setter methods to set these values. And this square class inherits from the rectangle class. Because a square is a kind of rectangle in geometry, this inheritance structure seems appropriate. The square class's setter methods for width and height don't take away functionality from the parent's methods, but instead add functionality, like adjusting its height to match the width, so it seems like there won't be any problems. However, from a broader perspective, the square class does not have the functionality to specify different widths and heights, unlike the rectangle class. In the square class, when you modify the width, the height also gets modified, and vice versa. For example, if the width and height of a rectangle are set to 5 and 4 respectively, and the area is calculated, the output will be 20. But if you replace it with a square, the width set to 5 becomes meaningless, and 16 will be output.
So it's not just a matter of overriding methods.
Yes. Therefore, if you want to design such programs based on LSP, it would be desirable to remove the parent-child relationship between rectangles and squares, and make them separate classes applying the interface called shape. Now that the rectangle and square are separate classes implementing the shape interface, there's no problem. The fourth principle is the ISP, the Interface Segregation Principle. This principle is simple. It states that a class shouldn't be forced to implement methods it doesn't use. In the last lecture, we said that an interface is like a certification. If you had to know how to operate not only a regular car, but also an excavator to get a driver's license, most people who get their driver's license would have to learn how to operate an excavator they will never use in their lifetime. Just as there are separate licenses for cars and excavators, interfaces should also be separated according to their responsibilities. Let's take a look at an example. This worker interface, designed to be implemented by factory workers, has work and eat methods. A class that implements this interface must implement these two methods. A regular human employee wouldn't have an issue performing both methods, but a robot does not eat. Therefore, if we introduce robot workers, this eat method would become redundant. Hence, we can separate this interface into workable and eatable, and allow regular employees to implement both, while robot workers only implement workable. Now, as long as the robotic employees only implement work of the workable interface, they don't violate the ISP. Lastly, we have DIP, the Dependency Inversion Principle. DIP is a principle that high-level modules should not depend on low-level modules, which might be hard to understand. Let's take a look at an example code. We have a fan class and a switch class. The switch class contains an instance of the fan class as an attribute, and when the methods to turn the switch on and off are executed, the fan operates and stops. Here, since the fan implements the specific action directly, it's a low-level module, and the switch provides abstracted logic to control this, making it a high-level module. However, in this code, the high-level module, the switch, is dependent on the low-level module, the fan. This is because the codes of the fan class, including the spin stop methods, are being used as they are inside the switch class. If the names or parameters of these methods are changed, the run part of the switch class must be modified accordingly. Also, in such a structure, a switch can't handle other electrical appliances besides the fan. Therefore, in the modified code, we create a separate interface called switchable that has turn on and off methods. And the fan implements this interface, becoming part of the switchable category. Then, the switch treats the objects of the classes belonging to switchable as properties and executes their turn on, turn off methods internally. The switch and the fan do not communicate directly, but communicate through this switchable interface. Now, any modifications to the fan's methods will not affect the switch class, and a switch can handle not only a fan, but also any other classes that implement switchable. With this, we have now covered all the solid principles. Each principle speaks to different aspects, but I believe you would have easily grasped what they collectively pursue. Remembering what you have learned in this video will assist you in understanding the object-oriented design patterns that you will learn later on. Starting with the next video, we will explore each of the major design patterns of object-oriented programming.